Everybody wants to take their seats. Well, get going. So welcome to this event at Eureka College, where we listen to Craig Shirley talk about his new book. This is his seventh, I'm told, seventh book that he's written. He's available here to talk about the book, and so we'll let him talk about what he wants to talk about, pretty much, and then we'll ask questions and we'll have some questions from the audience as well. There will be a book signing opportunity right over here, and I'm told the bookstore will be open a little bit later, out in the across the Moser lobby. So Craig Shirley is here with us. He's the author of the Reagan Legacy, Reagan Rising book. And his wife, Zoreen, is here as well. Where is Zoreen? Oh, there she is, front row. Welcome. Welcome to both of you. Craig is a graduate of Springfield College. He's the founder and president of Shirley & Bannister, a public relations firm based in Alexandria, Virginia. He is also, and we're proud of this fact, he is a trustee of Eureka College. He's the first Reagan author or scholar to serve in that role ever, so the first ever. He's a member and donor and longtime advisor to the Ronald Reagan Society of Eureka College. And he has done a number of things with the college, including a week-long class in 2012. And has helped secure speakers, and has been certainly a friend and a benefactor of the college. He's been the guest presenter for Eureka College's Reagan Centennial Conference on campus, Reagan in the Midwest, in 2011. He is the author of New York Times bestselling author, this is his seventh book. And I understand the New York Times has also commented about this book as well, and he'll tell you about that. So he left one of the statements that is in the book that perhaps we can begin some discussion here is the Craig Shirley says that Reagan left one of the greatest, was one of the greatest and most consequential presidents in history. So at this point, I'd like to welcome Craig Shirley, the author of Reagan Rising.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dan. I'm only going to speak for 2 or 3 minutes. Ronald Reagan once said that the definition of middle age is when you're faced with two temptations and you choose the one that gets you home in bed by 9:30. I plan to be home in my hotel room long before 9:30. I don't know how many times I've been to Eureka, but every time I come here, it is a special feeling. And I've told Dave and John in the past, it does in many ways remind me of my college at Springfield College in Massachusetts, also a small private school, a lot of brick buildings, leafy, a lot of green, and always a very, very friendly, convivial feeling to it, you know, like you belong there, like you're going home. Maybe Tennyson wasn't entirely right, you can go home. And I always felt that about Springfield. And since John and I have become, Morris and I have become friends over the years, and he and Dave have invited me here so many times, been so kind to me, and now Board of Trustees and all the other things, I always feel like I'm coming home whenever I come to Eureka. So. Thank you for that. I've written now 4 books on Ronald Reagan, and I plan to write other books as well. It seems to be my rendezvous with destiny. It wasn't that plan, really, I graduated from college deep into the last century. I actually started out as a phys ed major, and I thought I was going to be, doing push-ups and sit-ups for 50 years, and I then found out what public school teachers were making in 1975, and I went and changed my major immediately. But I'd always had an interest, an abiding interest in American politics and history. As I was telling Dan and the others at dinner tonight, is that dinners at my home growing up in the Shirley household were not for the faint of heart, because my parents were very, very politically involved. They've been charter members of the Conservative Party of New York, along with Bill and Jim Buckley and Kieran O'Doherty and Dan Mahoney and others, all visionary, seminal leaders in the early days of the American conservative movement. And my parents were right there with them. So they were very, very politically aware. They're very culturally aware. And so our conversations were, you know, in the 60s, and it was about war and peace and Vietnam and civil rights and politics and government and philosophy and all these things. And my father, although he left college to enlist in the, be drafted actually, in the Korean War, he was very sophisticated politically, was very, very knowledgeable. He was a city firefighter, but he was an autodidact. He read everything. I remember our coffee table at home had National Review, National Observer, Wall Street Journal, books on philosophy, Thomas Paine, all these other things. And my mother was right there with him. And so although he was in many ways an autodidact, he was an extremely well-read, literate man, and this he instilled in his three children. And our conversations were very, very contentious. But I learned there, I think, how to think even before I got to college. I had a professor in college who told me once, he said, the two most critical things you can get from college, if you get nothing else from college, you learn how to think and learn how to write. Those are the two most critical things you can get out of college. Fortunately for my parents, I learned, I think, how to think, at least in a rudimentary sense, before I got to college. I had a professor who did a lot for me and taught me a lot, including how to think and how to write. And so that led to an early love. Of course, I'd always loved books, even as a child, a small child. I read everything on Amelia Earhart and the Wright brothers and Charles Lindbergh and Jim Bowie and Thomas Jefferson and everything I'd get my hands on. But I think I learned from my professor at college a love of writing. So for many years, I wrote, but mostly for other people, for the politicians I was working for. I would write speeches for them, press releases for them, letters for them, op-eds for them. So there are many things that are floating out there even today somewhere in the blogosphere that, you know, by Gordon J. Humphrey was really by Craig and P. Shirley, a lot of things like that. But one thing led to another, and fate lent a hand. I had a client who had a publishing house, still has a publishing house, a very successful publishing house. It was Thomas Nelson, now it's Harper Christian. Harper Collins bought it some years ago. But when it was Thomas Nelson, they were a client of my firm, and we had a standing order that if we ever had a good idea for a book, to pass it along to the publishing house. And I remember one day talking to the president of Thomas Nelson. I said, you know, nobody has ever done a book on Ronald Reagan's 1976 campaign. It was his most important, because if he doesn't run in 76, he certainly doesn't run in 1980. And if he doesn't run in 80, then the world as we know it is completely vastly different. And Mrs. Reagan always said of his five campaigns, it was the most exciting of all. And he said, well, that's a great idea. I said, do you think you can get somebody to write it? I said, I'm sure I can get somebody to write it. And I went out and I asked a dozen different people. And nobody everybody agreed it was a great idea. Nobody was interested or had the time or the whatever else to write the book. And so I reported back to the publisher. I said, I can't get anybody interested. They all think it's a great idea, but they're all busy with other things or doing other things, so they don't think they're up to writing the book. And he said to me, he says, well, why don't you write it? And those few little words changed the course of my life. I wrote that, I remember 3 weeks after, he said to me, he said, why don't you write the book? And 3 weeks later, I got a Federal Express package with a contract and a very large check. And the good news is about, the bad news is about getting a contract is you have to write a book. The good news is you have to write a book. And so I just set out as methodically and as organized as possible, and I tried to talk to everybody and interview everybody, and I wrote Reagan's Revolution, and it came out, sold well, made the Washington Post bestsellers list, was reviewed well, and then another publishing house called me several months after the tour and the promotion concluded with Reagan's Revolution and ISI Books, very important academic house in Delaware. And the head of he said, the story's incomplete. I said, yeah, I know. He says, well, we want you to write the rest of the story for us. So once again, I got a contract and a very large check. And I had to, you know, I had to write the book because I spent the money. So I wrote that, and just one thing led to another. And so now it's led me to writing this fourth book, because this is a very important time. And let me just conclude it here and tell you about the videotape we want to show you, is that it's hard to explain, but there's a maelstrom going on in the 1970s, and there's a maelstrom of activity going on in the 1970s on the world stage and here in America. Most of it bad, all of it interesting, some of it good. Is that in many ways, you know, my son who helped me write the foreword, Andrew is so good at these things, of seeing things that sometimes I miss. He said, you know, is that there's a conservative enlightenment going on in America in the 1970s. I said, yeah, I know, I just wrote a book about it. And he says, but Dad, it's exactly 200 years after the conservative enlightenment of 1776. And I understand his point is that there is a symmetry to American history, is that things do repeat themselves. And so I wrote that and expressed that, is that out of the 1970s comes creative revolt across the land because government has failed at all levels, is that there's creative revolt over Prop 13 out in California, which later sweeps the country. There's creative revolt against the Panama Canal treaties. There's creative revolt in the growth of the conservative intellectual industry. The Heritage Foundation is created, AIM is created, the National Conservative Political Action Committee, Fund for a Conservative Majority, Richard Viguerie's company takes off. In a thousand different ways, there are examples of a conservative enlightenment taking hold. Buckley, George Will, Pat Buchanan, William Safire all become nationally syndicated columnists in the 1970s, and then other conservative columnists follow, which was unheard of in the 50s and 60s, is that there was, you know, there were only liberal columnists. There weren't really any conservative columnists to speak of. And so this is a more tangible evidence of creative, intellectual, conservative revolt in the land, which, of course, Reagan is the avatar. Reagan is the natural leader. And it all combines to produce the revolutionary election of 1980, which I wrote a book about. And I'm still going to write a book about 1984 because I wasn't originally, and then somebody pointed out to me, he says, you have to write 84, because if he doesn't win in 84, then 80 is meaningless. Is that if he loses in 84, then 80 is a detour in history. If he wins in 84, then 80 is a signal of the great shift in American presidential history. And as we all know, he won even by a bigger landslide, unlike as Donald Trump claims. He won by a bigger landslide in 84 than he did in 1980, which signaled that there was a conservative revival in America. But all of this has to happen with, is that Carl Jung said, is that there's a synchronicity to culture and history. Things happen for a reason, and that, you're going to say something. Yeah, you. Oh, okay. my wife is my best and my worst critic. I always get the afterwards. I said, well, you get an A for this. You get a D. You said too much. You said you know. You said you use too many first-person pronouns. So I thought, yeah, she's keeping notes. She's keeping notes. All this is happening in the 1970s, and then on the world stage is that we're losing the Cold War. We're literally losing the Cold War. The Soviets invade Afghanistan in 1979. Nicaragua falls to communists and later aided by the Soviet Union. El Salvador is under siege. Cuba, we know, had already fallen in the 60s, but now Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam all fall to communism in the 1970s. The Soviets and worldwide communism is winning, and worldwide freedom in the United States and the West is losing. It's tangible. There's no denying the obvious. So America is losing its culture at home. It's losing its way. It's losing its way of life. It's losing its economic prosperity at home, and it's losing on the world stage. Is that the 70s are, in my opinion, the worst decade in the history of the American Republic. And then you combine all that with John Travolta, Pet Rocks, gas lines, polyester leisure suits, bad disco music, not that there's such a thing as good disco music, is that the culture is just in shambles. Marriages are falling apart, families are falling apart, schools are falling apart. Is that there's no way to say that the 70s, the only good thing about the 70s was they ended. I wrote this book, Reagan Rising, because I left a gap. The book on 76 ends at the 76 convention in Kansas City. And then the book on 80 really begins with the Detroit Convention 1980, then does somewhat of a flashback, and then it gets right into the meat of the campaign, which really starts in the fall of 79 with his announcement for his third announcement for president in November 1979. It's not a trilogy, it's not a Star Wars type, you know, chapter 37 first and then chapter 1 second or whatever else like that. But I realized there was a gap in Reagan history, and I needed to do this to explain exactly how he became the revolutionary leader he became in 1980, what issues he was doing, what things he was taking advantage of, everything else. But I'm gonna conclude it here, except to say I'm gonna show you this videotape. This is Reagan's concluding remarks at the Kansas City Convention in 1976. The more I watch it, the more I learn from it, and it's only 7 minutes long. I used to think that his speech for Barry Goldwater was his most important political speech of his life. I'm almost convinced now this is even more important because this is a speech. Now, he's just understand is that he's just lost the nomination of Gerald Ford by 67 delegate votes out of 2,269 cast the night before. 69 votes out of 2,269. And Reagan also knows that Ford has done some underhanded dealing in the Ohio, Pennsylvania, New York, and New Jersey delegations. But that's not enough, is that he's also used all the baubles and toys and shiny objects of the White House and of the incumbency to bring over. At the time, there were about 150 uncommitted delegates. We don't have uncommitted delegates anymore, but you used to have a lot because they would go to conventions, cut deals to get the best deal for their state or the best deal for their party or the best deal for themselves. These 150 uncommitted delegates were free to vote their personal preference. They could vote for Ronald Reagan or they could vote for Gerald Ford. Well, Gerald Ford invites them to state dinners with Queen Elizabeth, invites them to sit on the deck of the USS Forrestal in New York Harbor to watch the July 4th bicentennial fireworks, invites them into private meetings in the Oval Office, invites them for flights on Air Force One. He does anything and everything to get these uncommitted delegates. And Reagan is Reagan. You know, he doesn't have this power at his disposal. He doesn't have, you know, all the trappings of the White House. He's a celebrity, absolutely. You know, a conservative celebrity, definitely. But all he has is persuasive skills and maybe the help sometimes of some friends like Jimmy Stewart or John Wayne, you know, who would call uncommitted delegates or maybe meet with uncommitted delegate. But other than that is that he can't match the firepower of the Ford White House. So this plus the underhanded dealing results in Ford's nomination, even though Reagan and many of his people believe that it's been stolen from him, or at least borrowed against heavily. Now, Ford gives an acceptance speech, which is actually, for Jerry Ford, is pretty good. Jerry Ford was widely known, you know, one time Newsweek did a cover story called him President Klutz, because he was widely known, as many of you remember, as being you know, ham-fisted, being, you know, star-crossed, malapropisms, is that he couldn't formulate a complete sentence, a simple declarative sentence. He was falling down ski slopes. He was falling down the stairs of the jetway of Air Force One. He's bumping his head on the entryway to Marine One. I mean, it goes on and on and on. He goes for a state dinner with the premier of Japan, and he's photographed in a black tuxedo, and his pants are too short. It just goes on and on and on. He's seen as a very star-crossed individual, but he does win the nomination. But he knows he's presiding over a divided party. Now, at this point, this is August 1976. The Democrats, the month before, had already had their convention, nominated the unusual candidate, Jimmy Carter, at a Unity and Harmony convention, which then itself was unusual for the Democratic Party in New York City. He picks Walter Mondale, the perfect pick to unite the party between the moderate conservative and the liberal. And don't forget too, this is in the wake of Watergate. This is the wake of Nixon's resignation. The Republican Party is almost dead as a political institution. A lot of columns were being written that the Republican Party was dead. I can get into this in Q&A, but the Republican Party is in dire straits in every measurable way, in terms of fundraising, in terms of elected officials, in terms of ideas, referenda, everything. But now the polling has Carter ahead of Ford by 30 points. 30 points. Ford knows if he's got a chance, he's got to produce a unified convention, because unified conventions tend to win in the fall, divided conventions tend to lose in the fall. And if you think about it over the last 30, 40, 50 years, is that the Republicans were divided in 64, the Democrats were united. The Democrats were divided in 68, the Republicans were united. The Democrats were divided in 72, the Republicans were united. The Democrats were united in 76, the Republicans were divided. In each of those instances, the divided convention goes on to lose, the party lose in the fall, and the united convention tends to go on to win in the fall. So he's got one narrow shot, and that is he's got to get Ronald Reagan down to the podium to speak to his delegates and speak to the convention hall, unify the party, and give him a fighting chance against Jimmy Carter. You don't see it here, but Reagan is in his skybox high above Kemper Arena in Kansas City. Tom Brokaw has just done an interview with Governor Reagan on national television, and he asked him, "Governor, are you going to address the convention?" Reagan says no. And then after Ford completes his speech, and he knows he needs Reagan on the podium to produce a unified convention, the Ford family and the Bob Dole and Elizabeth Dole, they're all waving to Ronald Reagan, "Come down, come down, come down." And Reagan is standing in his skybox, you know, giving the thumbs up and shaking his head no. And then 17,000 people, including Zareen, my wife, who was there that night, they start chanting, "Reagan, Reagan, Reagan, and we want Ron, and we want Ron." So Reagan now has the enormous pressure of 17,000 people imploring him to come to this to podium, plus the knowledge that the convention is being broadcast on all three networks live. So millions of people are watching around the world. Only reluctantly does he leave his skybox, make his way down to the podium, and as he's making his way down, he turns to his old aide, Mike Deaver, and he says, "Mike, what will I say?" And Deaver says, "Governor, you'll think of something." And this is what Reagan thought of, and this is what Reagan said, and this is the speech, I'm convinced, which not only launched the 80 campaign, but which ended up changing the world. Can we go ahead and show it?
Republican family that will give the leadership to the American people to win on November 2nd, I would be honored on your behalf to ask my good friend Governor Reagan to say a few words at this time. Mr. President, Mrs. Ford, Mr. Vice President, Mr. Vice President-to-be. The distinguished guests here and you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to say fellow Republicans here, but to those who are watching from a distance, all those millions of Democrats and independents who I know are looking for a cause around which to rally and which I believe we can give them. Mr. President, before you arrived tonight, these wonderful people here, when we came in, gave Nancy and myself a welcome. That, plus this, and plus your kindness and generosity in honoring us by bringing us down here, will give us a memory that will live in our hearts forever. Watching on television these last few nights, and I have seen you also with the warmth that you greeted Nancy, and you also filled my heart with joy when you did that. May I just say some words? There are cynics who say that a party platform is something that no one bothers to read and it doesn't very often amount to much. Whether it is different this time than it has ever been before, I believe the Republican Party has a platform that is a banner of bold, unmistakable colors with no pale pastel shades. We have just heard a call to arms based on that platform, and a call to us to really be successful in communicating and reveal to the American people the difference between this platform and the platform of the opposing party, which is nothing but a revamp and a reissue and a running of a late, late show of the thing that we've been hearing from them for the last 40 years. If I could just take a moment and I had an assignment the other day. Someone asked me to write a letter for a time capsule that is going to be opened in Los Angeles 100 years from now on our tricentennial. It sounded like an easy assignment. They suggested I write something about the problems and issues of the day, and I set out to do so, riding down the coast in an automobile, looking at the blue Pacific out on one side and the Santa Ynez Mountains on the other, and I couldn't help but wonder if it was going to be that beautiful 100 years from now as it was on that summer day. And then, as I tried to write, let your own minds turn to that task. You're going to write for people 100 years from now who know all about us. We know nothing about them. We don't know what kind of a world they'll be living in. And suddenly, I thought to myself, if I write of the problems, they'll be the domestic problems of which the president spoke here tonight. The challenges confronting us, the erosion of freedom that has taken place under Democrat rule in this country, the invasion of private rights, the controls and restrictions on the vitality of the great free economy that we enjoy. These are our challenges that we must meet. And then again, there is that challenge of which he spoke, that we live in a world in which the great powers have poised and aimed at each other horrible missiles of destruction, nuclear weapons that can in a matter of minutes arrive in each other's country and destroy virtually the civilized world we live in. And suddenly it dawned on me, those who would read this letter 100 years from now will know whether those missiles were fired. They will know whether we met our challenge, whether they have the freedoms that we have known up until now will depend on what we do here. Will they look back with appreciation and say, thank God for those people in 1976 who headed off that loss of freedom, who kept us now 100 years later free, who kept our world from nuclear destruction? And if we failed,
they probably won't get to read the letter at all because it spoke of individual freedom, and they won't be allowed to talk of that or read of it. This is our challenge, and this is why, here in this hall tonight, better than we've ever done before, we've got to quit talking to each other and about each other and go out and communicate to the world that we may be fewer in numbers than we've ever been, but we carry the message they're waiting for. We must go forth from here united, determined that what a great general said a few years ago is true. There is no substitute for victory. Mr. President.
Serena wanted me to tell you that she was, though she was there that night, she was only 8 years old. I always learned something new watching that. You know, there was great animosity between Gerald Ford and Ronald Reagan. Okay. There's great animosity, which is really ironic because these are two of the most affable men in American politics. They really were truly likable men, but they couldn't stand each other. And Reagan had a lot of griefs against Ford over the primary campaign, over the slurs about his intellect, and in the Ohio primary, Ford ran commercials calling Reagan a warmonger, and it got so bad. You know, one time there was a bad exchange. Gerald Ford was quoted in the primaries, said, you know, we both played football. We both once played football. I played for Michigan and Reagan played for Warner Brothers. And so when reporters went to Reagan, they said, Governor, this is what the president just said. And Reagan thought for a second, said, and he responded, well, at least I played football with a helmet. And while they could barely be in the same room with each other, Nancy Reagan and Betty Ford couldn't be in the same state with each other. And I thought it was interesting here, I just noticed it, is that as Ford is going through the motions and introducing Reagan and lying through his teeth about my great friend Ronald Reagan, is I see this look on Nancy Reagan's face and she looks sidelong like this, and I can see what she's thinking in her mind. She says, what the hell is he talking about? It's interesting. The other thing, too, is that he tells the audience, let your own minds turn to that task. What a great involving technique to bring your audience in to get them to see what you're saying through their own eyes. I mean, that is a true master speaker, and what a marvelous way to make it meaningful for people by getting them to see what your task is, the task been given you, to them, to they themselves undertake that task. Anyway, is that Reagan gives a speech, 17,000, but millions watching on NBC, ABC, and CBS, including me. I was in 1977. I was slinging hash at a seafood restaurant in Cape Cod, and I watched this speech on the bar, on the TV over the bar, and I watched it, and I said, I'd always been politically active, as I mentioned before, but I said, I got to get involved. I was motivated. And there were probably thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, maybe even millions of others, Americans, who decided to get involved because of this speech. And after this speech, everywhere he goes across the country, now he's out campaigning. He really didn't campaign for Jerry Ford, and as you notice, he never really endorsed him either. But he's campaigning for House candidates, Senate candidates. He's speaking out on issues. He's given, you know, speeches to Young Americans Foundation, Young Americans for Freedom. And everywhere he goes, sky cabs, police officers, firefighters, chambermaids, housewives, all of them, wherever he goes, people are employing them saying, Governor, you've got to run one more time. You've just got to run. And so I think the seeds of the 80 campaign were in this speech at Kansas City because it resulted of such an outpouring of the American people that he felt very, very directly, and which pushed him toward, even though he was going to be 69 years old in 1980, which pushed he and Mrs. Reagan toward, because by the end of the, campaign, after Carter wins and Ford loses, he convenes a dinner at his house in California, he and Mrs. Reagan, with all of his aides from the 76 campaign. Now, they weren't seeing or feeling the outpouring that Reagan was getting all across the country in the fall of 76. But Mike Deaver and Peter Hannaford were, and they were handling his schedule, his radio commentaries, his syndicated column. They traveled with him. They saw him up close and personal. They're very close friends. And while the aides, you know, John Sears and others were poo-pooing him running one more time, the California mafia was all for it, including Mike and Peter, because they saw the outpouring that Reagan was getting all across the country. So Reagan started the 80 campaign really with mostly just his old California aides, Lynn Nofziger and others there, and none of the outsiders. So that's why I consider this speech important.
So Craig, thank you for coming today to Eureka College to talk about your book and to talk about Reagan. But as I think Nancy Reagan would say, that you have taken the role of helping to maintain the Reagan legacy, and you also have a political history that you haven't talked about too much yet, but led you to not only write this book, but to write about Reagan. Maybe you could talk about that a little bit.
Well, I was out in California last week, and I spoke at the Reagan Library, and I spoke at the Reagan Ranch. And I did point out, because one of the questions was, are you planning on other Reagan books? And the answer is yes, because I'm going to write about 84. I'm going to write about 68, because people don't realize how close he came to the nomination against Richard Nixon in 68. He only lost by 200 or 300 delegate votes with a very late starting campaign. And, you know, they polled alphabetically, you know, Alaska, Alabama, Arizona, and then, you know, down to the W's. And Nixon doesn't get the nomination until they're at Wisconsin. They have to go through the entire alphabet before Richard Nixon goes over the top. And Nelson Rockefeller and Ronald Reagan got a healthy share, so Richard Nixon never had complete control of the Republican Party. So I plan on writing that book. Nobody's ever done a book about him and his lifetime war against communism. I'm going to do that. I've sometimes thought about just going back. You know, Edmund Morris failed miserably at Dutch. It was a travesty. It was atrocious. He channeled himself in there. He made up stories. He got his facts wrong. And he was the wrong selection to become the Reagan biographer. He was absolutely wrong because and I think it was wrong more culturally than anything, because he was from South Africa. I don't think he understood American politics, and I certainly don't think he understood American conservatism or American populism. And so Edmund Morris was flummoxed. He didn't understand Ronald Reagan. He didn't understand America. He didn't understand middle America. He didn't understand. He was an academic who thought, you know, people like me were probably tacky or something, because we weren't head of the, you know, history department, or we didn't have an advanced degree, which is how history used to be written. You know, who wrote The Missiles of the Guns of August? Barbara Tuchman was widely derided by historians, even though she wrote several brilliant books. Including, as we know, the Guns of August. But she only had an undergraduate degree. She didn't have an advanced degree, and she was never the head of a college history department or political science department. So her peers thought she was some kind of primitive bohemian, you know, scratching out, you know, on ink blots on bearskins or something like that, you know. And that's the way history used to be written. And I think. One of the things that I like to distinguish, I believe I distinguish myself when I write this type of history, is that Doris Kearns Goodwin writes from 100,000 feet or 10,000 feet or whatever. She talks, you know, she's from Boston, and as we mentioned earlier about the Cabots and the Lodges, and I think that, you know, she only talks to either the Cabots or God. But she doesn't talk to the people on the ground who stuff the envelopes and man the phones and go door to door and give rides to polls. And I do. That is, I think, what distinguishes my history books from her history books, is that I don't spend a lot of time talking to cabinet officers who try to put a gloss on things to make themselves look good for history. I talk to the people at ground level who just are thrilled that somebody's interested in what their historical experience was. Is that the things that I would never would have found out had I not talked to precinct captains in Missouri and city block captains in Concord, New Hampshire, and things like that. And it was, in some ways, their history is more important than the history at the top, because the history at the top tends to be very glossed and heavily spun, and you find out later is that they're only telling half the truth or whatever. So I think that's what distinguishes my view and my treatment of history versus others' treatment of history.
Good, and it shows up in the book, I think, as well. If in this particular time period where Reagan lost the election and then got it later, what was the, is there a lesson for, maybe we have some students here, perhaps, are the lessons for those?
There are a number of good lessons. One is take advantage of every opportunity that's handed you. Is the Panama Canal trees, which we've all forgotten about or faded into memory, were an enormous issue in this country in 1977, 1978. And it was truly a populist issue because every school child in America had grown up being taught that the Panama Canal was one of the seven wonders of the world. And the America ingenuity and know-how and leadership and Teddy Roosevelt built the Panama Canal. So where the French had failed and other countries had failed, the United States succeeded because the United States was part of what believed in American exceptionalism. And the Panama Canal treaties were treated in American history, school children history, grade school and junior high school and high school history, the same as the Statue of Liberty and the Empire State Building. It was a monument to American exceptionalism, American know-how, American ingenuity, and America's drive for success. Every school child learned that. So, and including Ronald Reagan. And so, and this was still, I mean, this is all forgotten now. We don't even spell America right anymore, I don't think. Spell it with a K. So when Ford and then later Carter proposes giving the Panama Canal treaties, Panama Canal back to the country of Panama, which was at best a banana republic, there was a huge outcry. And Reagan was upset. He did a lot of radio commentaries. He did a lot of columns. And he led a Panama Canal truth squad around the country, flying around the country, holding airport press conferences with other conservative leaders and other politicians, Jesse Helms, some Democratic politicians who were against what was known as the giveaway of the Panama Canal. This became such a big issue. Jimmy Carter is in danger of losing because the grassroots have bubbled up and told their senators, don't vote for the treaties. This has become such a big issue. Jimmy Carter goes on national television to broadcast a half-hour speech on making the case for the Panama Canal treaties. In that speech, he attacks private citizen Ronald Reagan. Not by name, but Reagan had gained a lot of traction in 76 and 77 with the phrase, and his audience would go berserk because, he'd thunder, we built it, we paid for it, it's ours and we're going to keep it. And the audiences would go nuts. And Jimmy Carter goes on national television and he says, I must repeat, we didn't pay for it, we don't own it, and we can't keep it. The next day, CBS Network, calls private citizen Ronald Reagan and says, Governor, would you like a half hour of primetime network television to respond to President Carter? It would never happen today, ever. But so CBS, so he goes live on CBS for a half hour to respond to Jimmy Carter's attack on him over the Panama Canal Treaty. So one is take advantage of your opportunities.
Two is that the ideal, the application practicality of idealism, where Reagan believed something and he was going to pursue it as long as he could. And I think third is and this is serendipitous, but to be in the right place at the right time. And Reagan made sure that he was as often in the right place at the right time as possible.
He was an idealist in a lot of ways.
Yes.
But he was also very practical in his politics.
Yes.
And that there was some appeal to that. And
from a governing standpoint, yes.
From the governing standpoint and from the recognition that the people had that elected him.
Right.
What was it about that that was attractive at the time in that environment that you write about?
Well, Republican Party was almost dead anyway, so anything they could get, they considered a step ahead. but it really was true, is that the Republican Party in 1977, 49 out of 50 states have near or total Democratic control of the governorship and the legislature. Only Kansas, the only state in the country that has Republican control of the governorship and the legislature. There were states in the South, Mississippi and Alabama, chiefly among them, that did not have one constitutionally elected Republican. Not to the legislature, not to the executive offices, nothing. Not one Republican. The Republican Party was at 18% approval, and among voters under 30, only 11% identified with the Republican Party. Which means is that if young people don't believe in your party, then you know within a few years you're not going to have a party, right? That's how bad off the Republican Party was, is that in 1975, they had to close their offices on Capitol Hill for 3 weeks during Christmas break just to save on the electricity bill. They had no new ideas, they had no new initiatives, they were in the minority, they were in the distinct minority in the House. They only had, I think, 145 House members out of 335. And in the Senate, they had fallen to 33, 34, which means they couldn't even mount a filibuster to stop. They couldn't even mount the one-third needed for a filibuster to stop legislation, unless they got a few Democrats to cross over and help them, which was very, 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 very rare. Occasionally they did on some appointments by Jimmy Carter, some initiatives, SALT II chiefly among them, because they got John Glenn and Fritz Hollings and a couple of Democrats to cross over and help them with a filibuster against SALT II. So compromise was, you know, anytime the Republicans could compromise, they would consider it a good day. But obviously, too, is that, I'm always asked about the change, about the differences and similarities between Trump and Reagan. Even after Reagan redefines the Republican Party, even after he reinvigorates the Republican Party, even after, in 1980, dozens of governors and hundreds of state legislators and dozens of congressmen, he does get control of the Senate in 1980, but he never ever controls the House. Mm-hmm. And you look at the environment that Donald Trump operates in today. He has the Senate, he has the House, he has most of the state legislatures and most of the governors. So he has a far more favorable political, dynamic atmosphere today than Reagan did in 1981.
A president's dream.
Yes, exactly. Sure.
So
the only thing better was Carter, when he was elected in 77, had everything politically, and he squandered it all away.
Yeah. So there was a time, and this is the time at which it is the election and re-election and the challenges that he faced. Was there, has there been anything like that in the past that you could compare it to, the period of time?
There have been a number of exciting elections. There have been a number of cliffhanger elections. But very few elections which actually change the course of America's future. 1800 changes the course. 1860, 1932, 1980, I would say the four most revolutionary elections in American presidential history, because we're on one course under Adams And Jefferson is elected, and it's like a cue ball hitting eight ball and sends country's history off in a vastly different direction. Same with 1860, same with 1932, and again, 1980, because we're on a certain course, and then Reagan's election sends us off on a radically different course. Most elections are, gentle breezes that only push around the ship of state, but some are torrential storms.
And then to look at that time period in the context of what was going on at the time, and in doing so, you have attracted some responses, some critics, some scholars have commented. And what's your response to the book that you've written, and what kinds of criticism have you gotten so far that would be interesting to share with us?
I never respond to critics except to say they're wrong.
That's a pretty good response.
I haven't had any critics on this book. It's been surprising. It's been across the board. The New York Times, National Review, many other publications and columnists and things like that. I haven't had really any criticism. And I don't recall really any of my Reagan books. When I wrote the book on World War II, I knew I was diving into the deep waters of World War II history, and there are a lot of sharks out there. I wrote that under Lend-Lease that FDR sent battleships to Churchill. And by battleships, I didn't mean the proper title battleships, but simply meaning warships. And I got hammered by amateur World War historians saying, they were destroyers, they weren't battleships, don't you know anything? You know, so you know, it's that type of minuscule criticism, which, you know, allows the internet for these guys in bathrobes and eating off pizza in their mother's basement. who have nothing to do, too much time on their hands to do that. I mean, that's the danger now, really, is that when you write a book, so you have to be really, really careful. I mean, they've got technology out there. There was a guy who serially plagiarized from one of my books. I mean, he just lifted whole passages. And I remember Zerina and I, because it was odd, because he asked me to review his book, and so he has his publisher send me the book, and I'm looking at this. I said, Zerina, does this sound familiar? And she said, yes. Does this sound familiar? Yeah. And we start cross-checking, and he's lifting entire sentences, passages from one of my books. And later, we put it through one of the research kids who works for me, put it through the software process. You know, they have software now which can, pick up detect plagiarism, and this guy had just plagiarized, I mean, not just closely, but identical sentences, identical phrases, identical paragraphs, and he'd done it hundreds of times. What's interesting is that the Washington Post, their book section, gave this corrupt liberal writer who wrote a really, really bad book about Ronald Reagan, and I mean really bad, he just made stuff up. The stuff that he didn't steal from me, he made up. And the Washington Post gave him a favorable review. Gave him two favorable reviews. So I decided, well, I'll have my just dessert. So I had my aide put in my bio that one of my greatest honors is my books have never been reviewed by the Washington Post.
That's a good thing.
Yeah. Right.
So as we've read this book and you're talking about it, there's something about the Reagan legacy that you've brought forward that is certainly positive. And, the number of conclusions that one can draw from the book relative to the Reagan legacy and I mean, this is a positive, a very informative presentation. So what do you think people will get from this reading it?
The truth, the facts.
In the coming years.
Well, Reagan is now, you know, we've been talking earlier about Reagan and Trump, and then every president since Reagan has compared himself or invoked Ronald Reagan. And I think really now we're beyond that. Reagan now belongs to the ages. It's not important that he be relevant anymore to current national politics. Is that he's important simply because he's important to American history and American culture and world history and world culture. And it's not important anymore to say, well, Donald Trump is the next Ronald Reagan, or George Bush is the next Ronald Reagan, or Barack Obama is the next Ronald Reagan. I would never, ever even utter the phrase Bill Clinton is the next Ronald Reagan. I wouldn't, not even jokingly. I just don't want to be caught on tape saying that. But we're beyond that now. It took a liberal historian, John Patrick Diggins, his last book. He was in many ways the official historian for the American left of the 20th century. Diggins wrote a book about the labor movement, about the workers' movement, about the women's rights movement, about the environmental movement. But his last book, interestingly, is called Ronald Reagan, Fate, Freedom, and the Making of History. And I would recommend it to anybody to read. Because in this book, this liberal historian says Reagan is one of our four greatest presidents, alongside Washington, Lincoln, and Franklin Roosevelt, because he saved or freed many, many people. And Diggins considered that the ultimate definitive criteria for an American president. Did he save or free people? Anyway, I just found that interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. So you probably joined the ranks of a scholar, of the Reagan scholars, at least, if not an author.
There are many
on the topic.
There are more than a few college and high school professors and teachers who are rolling in the graves tonight. It's the idea of Craig Shirley being a scholar.
Okay. Is that something that you want to be, or is it?
Sure, of course. I think it's, you know, is that one of the National Review review that was done by Clark Judge, who was one of Reagan's speechwriters. This sounds terribly immodest, but I'm only saying it for a point of reference, is that, David Arnold's going to help me here, the Thucydides was the Greek general in the Peloponnesian War. Thucydides, he compared me to Thucydides because after fighting the war, he came back and wrote the definitive history, and he compared me because I was there. You know, in the 70s and 80s, so I saw the Reagan campaign, Reagan operation, Reagan people, Reagan himself, up close and personal. And so it seems appropriate that I'm writing the history because I knew it better than anybody else, just as he did when writing the history of the Peloponnesian War.
Thanks.
I'll take it.
Thanks for answering those questions. So would you take some questions from the audience?
Sure, yeah, I'd love to.
I'll try to move the microphone around if anybody wants to ask questions.
Yeah, I was wondering about Reagan's relationship with Ford. I think it's been said that Ford, in large part, blamed his defeat in 76 to Carter on Reagan.
Yes.
Because Reagan didn't go all out for him or was lukewarm in his support. And secondly, when Reagan died, he was the longest living, president.
Right.
But Ford, he hung on and he outlived, and that Ford, that was one of his purpose for living, was to outlive Reagan.
Well, as far as your last point, I can't speak to that, but it would make sense since he really despised Ronald Reagan. And he said so. He participated in an oral history, and the name of the book was Write It When I'm Dead, I think it was that. I did it with a longtime political reporter, and in it he made pretty clear that he resented Reagan, that he didn't think much of Reagan or the Reagan presidency, and thought very little of Reagan's intellect. It is true that in 76, Reagan never really endorsed Ford and campaigned very, very little for him. He campaigned with Bob Dole a little bit, And he made some commercials for the campaign, but they were more about the platform and the Republican Party in theory than it was going out there saying, Jimmy Carter stinks, Gerald Ford is the greatest thing since no starch socks, vote for Gerald Ford. He didn't do commercials like that. So, but it's wrong to say that Reagan cost Ford the election, and I'll tell you why. I interviewed extensively Dick Cheney, who at the time was Ford's deputy chief of staff. Don Rumsfeld was his chief of staff, and Dick Cheney was his deputy. And he said that actually Reagan helped Ford get in shape for the fall campaign, and he was like a sparring partner, and that Ford became a better candidate because of the Reagan challenge. He became sharper on the stump. He became quicker. He became more erudite, whatever. Plus the image, I mean, Reagan is the most popular conservative in America, and he's from the most populous state in America. So Ford beating Ronald Reagan is not an inconsequential thing. Is that he's beaten the most popular conservative, one of the most popular Republicans, and the former governor, former successful governor, two-term governor of the most populous, of the biggest state in the country. So this all enlarges Ford, enhances Gerald Ford, and helped Ford at least make the 1976 campaign competitive. Gerald Ford got 240 electoral votes. Ohio, that year, there were 3.2 million votes cast. Carter carries Ohio by 6,000 votes. Now, Carter is also endorsed by the Teamsters. The Teamsters are headquartered in Cleveland. It's not beyond the pale to think that the Teamsters somehow delivered 6,000 phantom votes for Jimmy Carter. Jimmy Carter also carries Hawaii by 5,000 votes. So if Hawaii and Ohio flip, and somebody with the Ford campaign, you know, there's a leper colony in Hawaii, and somebody in the Ford campaign later after the campaign lamented that Ford never said anything about the leper colony. And if he had said something about the leper colony, he may have gotten their votes and won Hawaii. I thought it was funny. But if Hawaii and Ohio flip for Gerald Ford, it's 269 to 269 because that year there was one faithless elector in Washington State who votes for Ronald Reagan for president. And he couldn't be budged. Mike Padden, he's still alive. He was elected to the Electoral College in 1976. He voted, and Washington State went for Gerald Ford. But he refuses to cast his ballot for Gerald Ford, so he votes for Ronald Reagan. So it's 269 and 269, which means it goes to the House of Representatives. Now, presumably Carter would have won because the House was overwhelmingly Democratic. Although Ford had been there for 24 years, had a lot of friends there on both sides of the aisle, Carter was seen by many in the Democratic Party as a very, very odd duck, and a lot of people worried about his mental stability. So it's probable that Carter would have won the election if it had gone to the House of Representatives, but it's not outside the realm of possibility to think that there would have been some Democrats who would have voted for Ford because they saw him as being a stable force for good in American politics, and then they could still have control of the House and the Senate, and they could cut deals, in a Machiavellian sense with a president who won the presidency with Democratic House votes. No, Ford was wrong to think that Reagan cost him the election. Reagan did not cost him the election.
As you look at the current landscape of things and you look at the folks in the House and the Senate and the governor's mansions and maybe a few big city mayors, do you see a person who has the potential to be Reagan-esque
no.
in the Republican Party
no.
today?
No. No. I
true
don't.
Answer.
I see these guys on cable television. I'll see these guys on cable television. In 1981, Reagan was pitching the tax cuts to a group of conservatives. And he said, yeah, the tax cuts are about the economy and the tax cuts are about jobs. He said, but what the tax cuts are really about is reordering man's relationship to the state. Now, A, that's a very profound thought. B, is that who in national politics, outside of maybe Newt Gingrich, talks like that anymore? Does anybody even understand the allocation of power and the proper role of power, and that power is only finite? You know, it can be here or there, but it can't be in both places. Reagan understood power. Is that I don't think there's anybody, and politics, if nothing else, it is about the allocation of power. Is that I don't think there's anybody in national politics, certainly on the Republican side, definitely on the Democratic side, who understands what American politics truly is about. So the answer is no. So the next best thing is to hope for is an intellectual conservative, an ethical, honest, corrupt-free intellectual conservative. And again, they might not exist either.
Good evening, Mr. Shirley. It's certainly an honor and a pleasure to hear you here. I think it's my third or fourth time, and I very much enjoy coming back and hearing your thoughts on history that I lived through, but certainly don't remember as well as you do, or certainly didn't write about it. But my question involves a comment you made about the makeup of the Congress, both the House and the Senate,
right,
and the state legislatures and the governor's mansions when Reagan was elected, versus today, we see nearly a complete reversal.
Right.
And my question really goes to the issue of conservatism. And what brings it to mind is the recent attempt to pass an alternative to the Affordable Care Act, AKA Obamacare. And when it didn't garner enough votes to even come up for a vote in the House, people were attacking the conservative branch of the Republican Party as being responsible for that. Which, you know, I think about Ronald Reagan and what he might have done with the majority in the House and the Senate and the states, because he got a lot done against those odds. So my question really is conservatism. Is it dead in America?
No. Conservatism is not dead. I think it's going through it like it always has been. It's going through an evolution because conservatism is dynamic. The proper state of American conservatism is to always be in a state of revolution. That's the proper state. And its origins are in the American Revolution, which is anti-status quo. So Reagan's election is significant because he's anti-status quo. And even all 8 years of his presidency, he's always running against the status quo of Washington. You know, here's Reagan, who's head of the national government for 8 years, and yet none of us ever think of Reagan as being a part of Washington, because he wasn't. John Kennedy was part of Washington. Lyndon Johnson was part of Washington. Richard Nixon was part of Washington. Jimmy Carter was part of Washington. Barack Obama was certainly part of Washington, as was Bill Clinton. But we never think of Reagan as being part of Washington. Is that because he always cast himself as being against Washington, as being an outsider, as being a revolutionary. You could say the same thing about Donald Trump, but the differences are also significant between the two. Reagan was interested in victories. Trump, I think, is interested in fighting. I don't know what Reagan would have done. I don't think there would have been. You know, in the 1980s, there was no Freedom Caucus, although Reagan did sometimes cast himself with the establishment and found himself on the opposite side of Jack Kemp and Newt Gingrich and Bob Walker and others. I remember in 81 is that Reagan had become convinced that the deficit was too big and we need to close the deficit, so we need to pass TEFRA, which was the Tax Equity Fairness Act of 1981, something like that. And it was a $100 billion tax increase, but Tip O'Neill had told Reagan, says, look, I will give you $3 in spending cuts for every dollar of tax increase in TEFRA. Reagan goes along with it. He's cast himself with the establishment because the first vote in the House in September, October of 81 is that the House Republicans, with a number of conservative Democrats, defeat TEFRA. Reagan's got to go on national television. He's got to, you know, cajole members of Congress. He eventually passes TEFRA, but he always regretted it because O'Neill never kept his promise. And as a matter of fact, They never did another deal again. You know, this idea that Chris Matthews has put out there, that he and Reagan were frat brothers and used to go out double dates together or something like that, that's crap. It's nonsense. Is that Reagan never trusted O'Neill, and O'Neill hated Reagan, and he said so in his book many, many times. Go check out Tip O'Neill's book, Man of the House. He devotes a whole chapter to bashing Ronald Reagan, Nancy Reagan, the Queen of Beverly Hills, Ronald Reagan. It was a sin that Reagan was elected. Reagan was the stupidest president since that he ever knew, and he'd known every president since Harry Truman. It went on and on and on, and Reagan never trusted Tip O'Neill, and they never did another deal again after Tougher. The 86 Tax Reform Act was done between Reagan and Dan Rostenkowski, who was head of the House Ways and Means Committee, who's up here from Chicago, who was chairman of House Ways and Means. He didn't do it with O'Neill. So this idea that, you know, they were you know, beer guzzling buddies who used to double date or whatever is just it's nonsense. But I think that so there wouldn't have been a Freedom Caucus because Reagan would have, you know, was the definition of conservatism, unlike Donald Trump. But Donald Trump is not the definition of American conservatism. But I think that if Reagan had control, you know, Reagan never had a control of the legislature in all of his elected years. He never had control in California, never had control in Washington. Maybe in a way that helped him become a better president because he had to become more skillful in his persuasive skills rather than just, you know, throwing a bill up to Capitol Hill and expecting it to pass. He had to really practice his ability to persuade people to come over to his side. So,
Trustee Shirley, welcome back to the President's alma mater.
Thank you.
Question, a hypothetical one. If a few more delegates would have been gone to Reagan in Kansas City, could Reagan have won the general election of 1976, or did the Republican Party have to fully pay for all the sins of Watergate?
That is, I've thought about that many, many times, and I don't get asked it often, but I do enjoy the question because it is a fascinating one. You know, what if history had taken a different turn or a twist? Is that, I think that Reagan would have won, and I'll tell you why, is because he would have kept every state that Gerald Ford kept, including, if you can believe this, New Jersey went heavily for Gerald Ford in 1976. But on the other hand, is that Carter carried the entire Cotton South except for Virginia, including Texas. Now, Reagan was hugely popular in Texas, even if it was an overwhelmingly Democratic state. It was a conservative Democrat, so presumably, and Carter carried Texas narrowly in 76. Reagan would have carried Texas, so there's no doubt in my mind. Carter also carried Mississippi narrowly, and Reagan, I think, would have carried Mississippi. Also, Reagan was more popular with union, lunch bucket, ethnic, blue-collar Democrats than Gerald Ford was. You know, people forget is that in 76, Carter ran as an outside reformer who was going to clean up the system. He was, in many ways, he was definitely a populist, agrarian, Jeffersonian, from the South. But he was also seen by many as being more conservative than Gerald Ford. In some issues, he actually got to Gerald Ford's right on. But he never would have gotten to Ronald Reagan's right. And I think that Reagan, you know, as I mentioned before, is that Ohio only goes 6,000 votes for Carter. So I think that Reagan would have stood a real chance of taking Ohio, Texas, Mississippi. Now, on the other hand, Michigan goes heavily for hometown favorite Gerald Ford, even though Democratic voter registration there was 2 or 3 to 1 Democratic. So it's open to question whether or not Reagan would have carried Michigan because he had no political ties there, unlike Gerald Ford, who was born and raised and been a congressman there for many years. So, but I still think, and also the one other thing, and I'll finish it there, is that everybody remembers the second debate between Ford and Carter when Gerald Ford says, there is no Soviet domination of Poland, and there never will be. And this is a time when there are 5 Soviet divisions in Warsaw. And he was just hammered for days on you know, for misstating the Warsaw Pact and the Cold War. So Reagan never would have declared Poland to be free and open the way Gerald Ford did in 76. So I think that Reagan actually would have won. And he had no ties to Washington. That's the other thing, too. The other critical thing. A lot of people saw Ford as a direct result, as the creation of Richard Nixon. Not only, you know, was he was, because Nixon picked him for vice president. Nixon resigned. Ford becomes president. There were a significant number of people who saw Ford as being the incarnation of Richard Nixon simply because he was standing in for Richard Nixon. Reagan was free and independent of all the problems of Watergate. So the more I talk about it, the more I realize Reagan would have won, or I believe Reagan would have won in 76.
Yeah. Maybe time for one more question, Dan.
The 7-minute video, no teleprompter. Mike Devers was apparently correct. Yes. He'll think of something. At the very end, it looks like Ford kind of interrupts him, and he could have spoken for another 7 minutes or longer, but right. it seemed like kind of an abrupt end.
I don't know. He, you know, it was so spontaneous, and this is the sad thing about presidential conventions now. Everything is scripted. Is the delegates have been reduced to one-dimensional cutouts of themselves. This was the last convention, one of the last few conventions, where delegates had really, really meaningful role. You know, is that they don't even have it anymore. Zuri and I used to go, you know, for the convention went on for 2 weeks. The first week was platform week, and then the actual convention took place the second week. And platform week was in some ways more interesting because the platforms were written by the delegates, and these were housewives and firefighters and small businessmen and priests and rabbis and people from all walks of life, so, you know, women, men from all walks of life, all across the country, average Americans, studious, well-read, you know, involved, and then they would come into Kansas City and they would go on to committees. All right, you're on foreign policy, you're on domestic policy, you're on national defense, you're on security. Yep. They would have all these committees. The committees would then take testimony from Henry Kissinger and captains of industry and CIA agents, and they would, and these people, you know, took their job very seriously. They would ask these people testify, they'd ask them questions, and then they would get together and they'd talk among themselves. Then they would write a document. They would write a platform for the Democratic Party, for the Republican Party. Very impressive documents. Detailed, intellectual, informative. And this became the basis of the party for the next 4 years, was the platform of the party. Is that you don't have that anymore. Is that the consultants have ruined everything. You know, an old friend of mine used to say, never forget the first three letters of the word consultant. Because they've taken the power away. You know, I said before, power can only reside in some places, but not in all places. That the power used to reside with the state parties and the delegates. Now their power has been taken away. It's gone to the consultants and the media advisors and all that. And they're the ones who now have the power inside both political parties, and it's a shame, frankly, because the parties are no longer, the last several conventions is that they didn't have platform week. Karl Rove wrote the platform. He just wrote it himself. You know, this is what my party stands for. You know, so anyway.
Thank you very much.
Is it about the speech? No, I don't think Ford cut him off. Is that it was so spontaneous, is I think that Reagan wanted to, you know, Disraeli once said to a young backbencher in Parliament, sit up, say what you have to say, and shut up and sit down. And I think that Reagan was going to say what he had to say. He was going to make it short. He was going to make it meaningful. He was going to make it thoughtful. And he was going to, sometimes, you know, brevity is better than speaking too long like I'm doing tonight.
Reagan Rising. Craig Shirley.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Books are available outside. Signing over here.